Welcome to Your Voice with Senator Marty Golden. I'm your host, Julia Lokendi. Hi, Senator. How are you?
How are you? Good to see you.
I'm doing well. And so with the budget, it's due in a little over a week. Can you tell us, are there any sticking points right now in the negotiations?
There's always sticking points in a negotiation. We're looking at the federal level. Donald Trump has laid out his proposal. Obviously, there's a lot back and forth on that document. But at the end of the day, there will be an agreement between the Senate and the Congress, and they will come to a conclusion, and they will have a budget for the good nation. Well, the same thing at the state level. We have the Assembly, the Senate, and we're negotiating. We're at different levels here in the negotiation. But I tell you, it's pretty significant. We're talking about, $160 billion budget, and we want to make sure that the money appropriately flows downstate, upstate, and that the resources that we have address the concerns in education, of which we've done over 30% increase in the last 4 years to education alone. So you're going to see that here in this budget as well. We're going to continue. That'll be over $1.2 billion, somewhere in that category, going to education. So we're going to be dealing with that's a big issue. And a big issue is jobs. Opening up the door for the opportunity to have and keep our kids here and not have them go to states like Texas and California and New Jersey and Connecticut and Massachusetts because they have tax credits for biotech, biomed, and they have real job opportunities. So we're going to be fighting to make sure that that's available to us. College is something we're going to make sure it's available to our kids across this great state, and especially in the city and in Brooklyn College, and working with Kingsborough and others to make sure we address those issues and our private colleges as well. And of course, transportation is a big issue. We want to make sure that we cover our transportation issues and the infrastructure. Those are issues of building the BQE and getting that done and making sure that there's enough housing as well, and dealing with 421A and making sure that we have appropriate housing going forward for the many people that need affordable housing within our city. And we have over 60,000 homeless people living in the city today on the streets. So we got to make sure we're in hotels. So we got to make sure that we get reduce that number and increase the number of housing units and, make New York City affordable again. A good governor of the state of New York has increased taxes like you would not believe in this budget, and we're stopping it. We're rejecting all this tax increase, and we're talking about a significant amount of increases that he put forward, $8 billion in taxes and fees. We're stopping that. We're not going to let that happen. Our people cannot afford to pay that. It's wrong, and we're going to fight for that to make sure it doesn't happen.
What about addiction? I know you have your eye out for, with everything going on with heroin and opioids. Is the Senate doing anything about addiction in this budget?
Well, we have a twofold. It's, some of this that you asked about sticking points is the two areas that we're looking at right now, the college affordability, and of course, the governor would like to see free college for people that live in the state of New York. It's not practical to give free college. It's, the middle class is out there striving to be able to put bread on the table and to get their kids through school, and they're paying an exorbitant amount of money today to get their kids through high school and to college. So we're going to work to come up with a plan where we can get additional tap to our CUNY SUNYs and into our private colleges. That's one of the big issues. But the other big issue is dealing with the raise the age, where they want to take 16 and 17-year-olds, 15, 16, 17, and 18, and take them out of the criminal system and put them into the family court system. Can't do that. There's got to be a balance to society and to life. And when you do that, when you have robbery and burglary, you can't send that to family court. Drugs, possession of a kilo of heroin, you can't send that to family court. Got to go to district attorneys in our counties across the state of New York. We're going to fight to make sure that that happens. And you talk about heroin here. Heroin deaths in our community, Staten Island's got 450,000 people that live on it. Number one in the state. Yeah, Brooklyn is number four, and we got 2.6, 2.7 million people living in it. Look at the disparity in numbers. And, Westchester and Nassau County are two and three. So what we got to do is continue to concentrate on making sure that we address the residential programs and the needs and the insurance issues that prevent families from getting their kids the assistance that they need and making sure they get them off drugs. So we're putting $32 million towards that. So we got that raise the age issue going on. We want to make sure we don't see any drug sellers or drug people in possession of drugs. going into the family court system. And we're going to make sure at the same time that we direct that $32 million, additional $32 million, towards residential programs and insurance and programs to get and to assist our families. The debt toll is amazing. When I tell you about this, it's very, very sad. The kids that are dying because of this, and the kids are anywhere from 11, and we got people up to 70, 80, 80 years of age taking amphetamines and you know, not just heroin, but it's not good. So we're on top of that. It's a big issue for us.
Mm-hmm. You had a news conference relating to disability for city workers. What was that about?
Well, we got to make sure that the when you get a disabled employee in the city of New York, or the fire, police, or EMS, what they do is they go for a hearing if they've been disabled. And what they do is they deny the individual from his disability or her disability, and then it's got to go to court. So then it goes to the judge, but the judge only has the right to send it back. It can't make a determination on the actual injury or the disability of that individual. So why do that? Why would we want to take a disability, send it to a court, have the court send it back, and have this back and forth, additional cost, person is in pain, they're without dollars, right? For it could take 2 years, 3 years to get this accomplished. So what we're saying in my legislation is, hey, give the judge the power to do what the board has failed to do. If the board denies and it goes to court, then the judge should have the right to make a determination. That's all we're saying. And I think that would be prevent a number of these issues from going back and forth in this you know, a game that they play. And it's just plain wrong.
What about the Senate put in extra money for direct care workers, people who help the disabled?
Well, that's pretty sad, too. The governor of the state of New York decided that we wanted to raise the minimum wage, you know, very well intended, I'm sure. But there are, you know, there's fallout from that. There are a number of direct care workers that deal with our handicapped kids and families across this great state. Not only that, but you have nursing, you have assisted living, you have health care workers, you have home care workers. None of that was taken into consideration. We're talking about another $1 billion a year to be able to pay for these increases to that industry. So right now, we made sure that we got $45 billion that was directly needed right now for those direct care workers, the ones that are dealing with those that have developmentally or disabled or have other medical issues, that we can have that money there so that they can get the money that they need to get to the minimum wage. We don't want to see the drain that we have. We have an employee drain because they don't get paid enough. Burger King's paying you $15 an hour. Why are you going to work for $11 an hour taking care of some 70-year-old woman that needs help that's in assisted living or nursing, or a handicapped child that needs the assistance of getting in and out of bed and getting to and from school? So we did that, and we made sure we put that $45 million into the budget.
Mm-hmm. I can see where the consistency of having that same person really makes a difference for people like that.
They want to see the same person every day. Yeah. You're getting out of that bed, you turn around, that person's going to take you, bathe you, clean you up, get you moving. So you want that consistency.
Mm-hmm, definitely. There's more information about the different budget initiatives on your website, golden.nysenate.gov.
Yes.
So the last time you were here, you told us about Officer Holder's Law, which would make sure serious criminals spend time behind bars, not in diversion programs. And today I want to ask you about the tragic death of EMT, mother of five, who was mowed down by a man with a violent past, who was let out on without bail for his last thing that he did in February, which was almost hit a police officer, I think.
No, it's sad that we're here today. And we're discussing that. The Holder bill is where they actually take an individual that's been arrested and they actually release him or her into a drug diversion program so that the person say, I'm a drug addict, the reason I did X was because I was on drugs. So the court say, okay, we're going to send you to a drug diversion program. But once, twice, three times? Come on. How many times are you going to send an individual to diversion? And that's what we see in Officer Holder being killed. We don't want to see that anymore. And now you look at this Ms. Arroyo, great person, great individual, mother, worked hard all her life, and you know, trying to stop this individual from taking her ambulance. What we don't have in the state of New York, which people will be very amazed to understand, there's no description or crime for gang members. This is a gang member. Yeah. We have the MS-13 has killed a number of people since September in Long Island. Probably about five people that have been killed in Long Island from the MS-13. This guy was a gang member again, and he's out on the street. And the judge has the audacity to say, well, he didn't have his transcript, his previous arrest. Is he kidding? All he had to do was hold them until those papers arrived. And then he would have seen that this individual had been arrested 31 times. 31 times. And he releases this individual, just looking at this individual, just knowing that the individual gang member, because he got the tattoos, he's standing there. I mean, the judge had to see him. It is crazy and absurd that he would release somebody without seeing his arrest record. I think it's absurd. And that poor woman today is dead because of that. Mm-hmm. That mother of five is dead today because of that miscalculation of that judge. And that's what happens with our judges sometimes. We got the greatest system. I think our judges do a great, great job. I'm going to tell you right now, 99.9 do a great job. But unfortunately, in this particular case, this judge did not do the right thing for that family, for the city, or for the state of New York. And that family is going to suffer now because of that.
Mm-hmm. And not even a psychological evaluation.
No,
of this
could you imagine? They want to we're talking about the raise the age and taking these kids out of the criminal court system, putting them into the family court system. I do believe 100% that you shouldn't be in a jail with an 18, 19, 20, 25-year-old. You should have separate quarters, and you shouldn't be mixed in with the older population, 100%. But to take this particular case where you're going to send them to family court, 31 times this guy's been in family court, this guy's been in criminal court system. We need to correct the system. We got to make sure that we promise our citizens in the city of the state of New York that this is not going to happen again. We're going to do something to correct this. We don't want to see this every couple of months. It's wrong.
No,
so that's what we're
going to prosecute.
Yeah. That's right. The system failed them.
Yep. All right. So very quickly, district events. I want to remind everyone you have a tax prep service in your district for people making less than $30,000 a year.
Well, I got a great community. I got a large senior population, and we have a large population that need our resources to get their taxes done. We've been doing this for years, and we got the College of Staten Island comes out, and Wagner College comes out, and the kids come in and they work. It's in my office and do these tax returns. And under the leadership of Jeff Krause, who was employed by me, he's also the adjunct at the not the adjunct. He's actually the in charge of the Wagner College, and he does a great, great job. So hundreds of tax returns will be done because of that. It's good.
And before we know it, Easter will be here. You're going to have some Easter egg hunts in your district, Saturday, April 8th and April 15th.
Right. We got one in Bay Ridge, and we got one over in Marine Park. Anytime kids come out, when I tell you to get lines of kids, it's thousands of kids come out at both of these events and families. And hopefully we get good weather and we have a good turnout. And by then, of course, we'll have the budget done and people will be happy, hopefully, with this budget that we do and that we do the right thing for the city and state of New York. And they'll know exactly what's going on with the federal budget as well. And I think it's all good at the end of the day.
One last thing. I saw a picture on Twitter of you and John Travolta. So tell us the scoop.
That John Travolta was in our community in Bensonhurst doing the Life and Death of John Gotti. And we were happy to have him there. But that is the film tax credit that I did in 2005. And it's created billions of dollars of income into our city and into our state. And it's created hundreds of thousands of jobs. And this is a direct result of that tax credit working here in the city and in Brooklyn. And we were happy to have him back. You know, he wasn't there since, a long time ago. He was back there in 1970s when he was there the last time doing a movie. So we were happy to get him back.
Thank you so much for being with us today, Senator.
You're quite welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Marty Golden. For additional information about community events and the budget, golden.nysenate.gov.